Hi, I'm Jim Campano, editor of the West Ender, and this is Joe LaPiccolo, assistant editor of the West Ender. The West Ender is a newsletter that is published quarterly and has a circulation of over 2,700 former West Enders. What we're going to do today is give you a little history of the West End, sort of a West End primer. The West End was taken by eminent domain in 1958. It was the first urban renewal project that took land by eminent domain and gave it to private developers. Before this, land or property could only be taken for the public good, schools, highways, etc. In April of 1958, the project was ruled legal by the U.S. Supreme Court, and the bulldozers and cranes were in the West End tearing down buildings before the end of May. The records show that there wasn't any citizen participation in the project in 1958, although other towns in Massachusetts, cities and towns that had urban renewal, had citizen participation. The 1954 plan had 4.8 acres of low or moderate income housing. It was reported extensively in the papers and subsequently dropped without any publicity. The West Enders never knew that the city had reneged on their promises. The West End project has since become an example of how not to conduct urban renewal. It was documented by Herbert Gans, who wrote the classic sociological study, Urban Villages. We hope to have Herbert Gans on the show someday, and he said if he is in the area and time permitting, he will come. There were certain promises made to West Enders in the 50s that were never kept. Promises that we would like to hold the city to. Promises of preference in housing, and the 4.8 acres of low or moderate income housing that was supposed to be built in the area. We have in the past year formed a community development group that will be part of the development process if the city wins its appeal on the Lowell Square parcel. We want to show what a tragedy it was to shower wholesale destruction on vibrant neighborhoods in the name of progress. Psychological studies of the relocated residents showed lasting depression associated with the dissolving of old interpersonal relationships. We want to make sure it never happens again in Boston. We hope to leave a permanent record of the West End in the form of the West End Historical Committee, which will show the West End in its true light, with all its strengths and with all its faults. The present developer of the area keeps trying to show the West End of 1958 in the worst possible light to justify his part in the worst example of eminent domain in U.S. history. In fact, the West End was run down, but no more run down than the North or South End, or the North Slope of Beacon Hill, which was of the exact same housing stock. Some people say it's 30 years ago, forget it. But I say it's wrong and should be remembered. And with all the documentation by sociological and planning studies to back us up, we should make sure that it never happens again. West Enders of 1958 were pictured and reported as living amid squalor and as being dirty and unkept. One report said that 60% of the families had at least one case of TB. It was also supposed to have had the highest crime rate in the city. Of course, most of the reports were later found to be false. False reports like the ones mentioned caused much resentment towards politicians of that time and towards Charles River Park, the developer of the area. This resentment is usually brought up each time West Enders meet, which is quite often lately. Why West Enders formed such an attachment to the area and to each other remains a mystery, but it was there. It was also reported by anybody who observed the area that it had a small village-like quality. In future shows, we will showcase former West End institutions such as the Elizabeth Peabody House and the West End House. And we'll try to tell them the West End experience from the people who live there. And now, Joe, would you give us a little thing about the West End, what the West End does?
Sure. Thank you, Jim. First, I'd like to emphasize that the newsletter, which began, Jim said, began about 3 years ago, it brought so much joy and happiness to former West Enders. It's read by West Enders, and not only young, old West Enders too, especially the elderly. The West Ender is published quarterly, and if they don't get their West Ender on time, boy, the phones start ringing, and they call, and they tell how it brings so much happiness, and tears stream down their eyes, reminiscing about their old West End days. And this is another thing it's done. After 30 years, this is the only means of communication between former West Enders. And boy, it's really brought a lot of joy and happiness to the West End people. And one of the good things that's come out of the newsletter, we have several. The first one we'll begin with is the West End Reunion Committee. And its president is Vincent LaPrestity. We've had approximately three West End reunions, and there's been upwards of over 2,000 West Enders at one of the reunions. And the hall is really, it's filled with joy and happiness and laughter. It's really, really magnificent.
Still is the one that I'm bowling.
Oh, it's great. Mm-hmm. And people have come from all over the country, from California and Texas and Florida. They've come from 22 states to come to this reunion, Chicago, and to see them come in and hug and kiss and tell each other stories about their boyhood days, because there is nothing to come back to except a reunion or except to the newsletter. It's all gone 30 years ago, yet they come back to see each other. That's what it's all about, people. Another thing, as a result of the West End newsletter, has been we've helped the West End House, camp. We've given scholarships to the West End House as a result of the reunion, the proceeds from the reunion, and also another thing that's resulted from the newsletter is the Elizabeth Peabody House Alumni Association, which is just coming off the ground, and it's made up of former West Enders. And the Elizabeth Peabody House, it was a settlement house of boys and girls. And one of the most notable things of the Peabody House is the playhouse itself. And many, many stars of today, especially Leonard Nimoy, he's one of the people who started. Got his start at the Peabody House, and also Ruth Roman, and it's noted all over the country for its playhouse, and we've also
he sent a letter to the newsletter.
Oh sure, that's right, Leonard just sent a letter to the, and one of the another things that's come out of the reunion is funds that we've bought new equipment for the Elizabeth Peabody House camp, which is great, and. One other thing we've also accomplished through our newsletter and through the reunion committee is the picnics for the elderly. There are two housing complexes made up of former West Enders, still in the West End, one called the Blackstone and one called the Amy Lowell House. And as a result, as they say, of the reunion, the funds collected, we've brought them to Camp Gannett and Sharon, and we've held picnics for them, plenty of food and dancing, and this has really lightened up their life. And they, again, get together with former West Enders and reminisce about their days in the West End, and they have a wonderful, wonderful, marvelous time. One of the other aspects that's come out of the newsletter is St. Joseph's Church, which is still in the West End. It's one of the only living... one of the only memorials left to the West End that's still standing, is they recently had a 125th reunion. And out of the goodness of Jimmy, he gave Father Buck of the St. Joseph's Church, he gave him the reunion list. And through that list, the hall was filled again. And once again, that's transpired from the newsletter, that the hall was filled with former West Enders. Father Buck didn't imagine I couldn't dream of the hall being filled again, because again, 30 years ago it was taken away. So those are some of the good things, and some of the future things we're working in, as Jimmy has mentioned, is development. There are two parcels of land left that have been undeveloped in the area of the Old West End. And one is called the New Chatham Street parcel. That's located near Knott Station and back of Langone's funeral home. Presently, it's being used as a parking garage for state employees. But the state recently got together a committee and formed a New Chatham Street committee to find uses for this land. And one of the uses is housing, affordable housing. And they invited Jimmy and myself to participate on this committee, and we attended numerous meetings throughout last summer or the summer before. And blessed by Governor Dukakis, they've agreed to give preference in this housing when it is built to former West Enders, which is, I think, is a great accomplishment. And one other parcel that's left is in the Knott Station area, and it's called the Lowell Square parcel, right opposite the new federal building. And although it's tied up in court, Rappaport, still, he's doing a job on the former West Enders. He doesn't want to see us there. But we're going to fight. We're going to fight all the way. And I'd say over our dead bodies will a brick or mortar be built there without preference to former West Enders. We're going to get that land back. And what has happened recently is the City of Boston, the Boston Redevelopment Authority, has appointed the Archdiocese of Boston as the future developer for this parcel. And Jimmy has had numerous meetings with the Archdiocese, and again, with the blessing of Mayor Flynn, who's been a great help to our organization, they have given preference to former West Enders to be housed in this development, which is wonderful. I think it's really, really, really great. What I'd like to emphasize, too, is one of the most important things that's come out of our newsletter is the West End Historical Society. What it is a oral history group, and we're taping former West Enders. It's a oral history of their, they're reminisce about their boyhood and girlhood days in the West End. And we have the tapings at the West End Branch Library on Cambridge Street in Boston. And that's again, we've taped approximately 50 elderly people, and boy, they enjoy. They come down and they really enjoy being taped and going over their boyhood, girlhood days in the West End. It's done. It's been really marvelous. And this is being done under the auspices of Paula Posnick, who's a librarian at the West End House Library. She's been the catalyst of this. And we've had great help from David Robbins, Professor David Robbins from Suffolk University. He's really directed this whole venture, and we've been able to use the equipment to get started from Suffolk University, and since then we've purchased our own equipment. So really, those are things that have transpired from the West End newsletter. Started off as a one-page newsletter, and now it's up to 14 pages, and it goes out to over 2,700 people, former West Enders, plus numerous clubs and societies and the legislature and the Boston City Council. And they don't get it, too. They call up. They enjoy it. It's history, and it's the only living memorial up at the West End. And our last goal is to have a West End Memorial Hall and Museum. And we want that located in the West End, and we have envisions of seeing this someday, where people can come from all over the United States and come into this West End Memorial Hall Museum and to look at their old friends. And we're collecting memorabilia of the old West End, and that's our other goal, and it will happen someday. Jim?
Okay, development update. On the Lowell Square, the West End CDC met with the representatives of the Archdiocese, who promised to give us at least as much as HD Development, who are our former partners. The Archdiocese filed complete cooperation with the West End group. The Archdiocese plan will not have rentals. It also will be a cooperative, and there will be no condos, which cooperatives are pretty similar to condos. They have slight legal differences. In the area, there should have been preference on urban renewal land. Anyone from the West End who was turned down for an apartment at the Amy Lowell Apartments or at the Blackstone Apartments called the newsletter. According to HUD regulations, former residents of an urban renewal clearance area are supposed to be given preference as long as they can afford the rent. I will now read the regulation. 121B, Article C, says to give preference in the selection of tenants for dwelling units built in the project area to families displaced therefrom because of clearance and renewal activity, who desire to live in such dwelling units and who will be able to pay rents or prices equal to rents or prices charged other families for similar or comparative dwelling units built as a part of the same redevelopment. That's the actual law. Our rights were not protected at the time by hostile and indifferent city administrations in the 60s and 70s. This has changed a little bit now with Mayor Flynn's initiatives. The Chardon Street update. Legislature to declare the Chardon Street law surplus died in committee and new legislation will not be submitted until the summer at the earliest. We had pickets in front of Charles River Park's rental office this fall, and some of the pickets wanted to picket the Chardon Street site to protest what they felt was a renege by the state on promises about Chardon Square Street. We stopped them, but they seems maybe we should have let them go. Joe, you have community news?
Sure, yeah. Next, we have some community news on things that's going to be happening. First of all, at the Elizabeth Peabody House, located in Somerville here, on February 4th at 1 p.m., there will be a children's series called Rumpelstiltskin. It's going to be a musical. And for more information, for reservations, call 623-5510. Next, on February 22nd, there will be a group starting called a group for Vietnamese women. For more information, call Julie Yeh at the Elizabeth Peabody House at 623-5510. Then sometime in February, there will be a Valentine's party for children. And we don't have the exact date yet, but it will be held in February, right around Valentine's Day. And again, for more information, please call Julie Yeh at 623-5510. Next along the line, in June, as in the past 3 years, we're going to have our annual Camp Gannett outing at Sharon, Mass. And the last 3 or 4 years, we've had over 500 West Enders at this picnic and outing. So we hope to have that again this year on June 25th. Next comes the West End House, which is housed in Alston. And this year, they're taking applications for the West End House Boys Camp, which is up in Maine, East Parsonsfield, Maine. And it's a great, a wonderful camp. So applications are now being accepted for the West End House Camp, East Parsonsfield, Maine, for boys 8 through 14 years of age for the 1989 season. For more information, call Bill Margolin at the West End House at area code 617-787-4044. Next, we're going to have the West End Historical Committee, which is located at 151 Cambridge Street, Boston. Telephone 523-3957. And
you're going to show a promo, huh?
Yeah, we're going to show a promo of that coming up now. And the West End House Historical Committee is a great organization. And I'll give you a little background on what we're going to be doing. From the middle 1800s to the late 1950s, Boston's West End was a cultural and social United Nations where immigrants came to establish themselves and their families in the United States. The West End Historical Committee was formed in May of 1987 to gather and preserve historical materials on this lost neighborhood of Boston. One of the committee projects has been an oral history taping project of former West Enders. This project attempts to recapture the sights, sounds, and culture of this once vibrant, colorful section of Boston through the memories of former inhabitants. The results will include an edited videotape, a series of videotapes for presentation, a booklet, and eventually a book. The following video is a sample of the selected responses to date.
We were all just blessed with a community that I say It's a sad thing to see a community of that nature get wiped out and no longer have the camaraderie that existed, not only among the adults, but even the youngsters, growing up together and mingling around and getting along together in school. It was, I still maintain, the greatest place this side of heaven to grow up in.
I miss the whole damn place. I've been away now 30 years and I miss it very much. I miss the give and take. I miss the laughter, the smell of the bakeries. I miss guys like Tabashnik. I thought he would be dead long now. There was a wonderful camaraderie there. As I said, maybe I'm coloring it because I'm older now, and where I live, it's very cold. Nobody knows anybody. I don't know what they are. There's no society. There's no community. West End was a community. There's no community today. I don't care where you go. Medford, Somerville, East Oshkosh, Newton, there's no community. Each one lives isolated in a house surrounded by a dog or a couple of cats. There's absolutely no such community. And there's no longer any such community here. But here, for the first time in my life, was the same kind of community I had where I was born. It was a village community. This was a village. I don't think that it's been repeated anywhere else in the city. I don't think it ever will be. I think it was just one of these accidental things that happened. You know, but you can't blame these guys. They didn't know they were destroying the village. They thought they were making plans and making money. And they said, I can't blame them. They're idiots anyhow. They'll die. They'll never know these things. But this was a village of people who spoke an archaic Russian, an archaic Yiddish, an archaic Italian. Or as I take Polish, because they hadn't been there for 70 or 80 years. And the sense of community was enormous. It was simply enormous.
I must say that you saw a little taste of what we're doing, and I must say that this is one of the most gratifying projects that I've ever worked on. It's magnificent, it's marvelous. To see the elderly, it just lights up their hearts to reminisce. I'd like to say that all those interested in participating in the project can contact Paula Posnick. She is the committee coordinator at telephone number 523-3957. All those wanting to make a donation toward the project completion can send checks made out to the West End Historical Committee, 151 Cambridge Street, Boston, 02114.
Well, we're coming to the end of the show, and next month, the Elizabeth Peabody House, 90 years of commitment to the West End and Somerville. Anyone interested in being part of the audience, please call the newsletter and we'll get you in. I just want to make one more statement, and that's to name the people that were on the video. They were in order: Frank Levine, David Schwachman, Nellie Jackman, George Leary, and Joe Caruso. Thank you very much, and looking forward to see you on our next video newsletter.